But tonight, I'm going to go through a lot of scripture tonight because the Word of God has so much on healing, and He wants us to have an expectation for healing. And you know, you may have been disappointed with different things that have gone down, especially, you know, people losing loved ones to COVID and different things. But, you know, God's still on the throne. And when we got saved, that word salvation is soteria, which means healing, deliverance, safety, preservation, and deliverance. So when we get saved, it's not that just that we're going to heaven, and I know many of you know this, it's just that, but He wants us to be operating in the fullness of what He has for us, and healing is one of those things. And you know, we have to press for this stuff, and you know, it's I know that, you know, we have to have a real word base in our lives in order to really to flow in this. And it's really important. Jesus can do whatever He wants. There can be instantaneous miracles, but I'm talking about healing tonight. And when you look up some of the words for healing in the gospel, it's therapeuta, which is therapy, which is progressive healing. Now, again, we know that God is a God of the suddenlies. He can instantaneously heal. We're all for that. But I'm talking tonight about, you know, many of us who have gotten sick, we had to fight for our healing, right? We had to press through. But if you don't have a word base, that is really important. And you can have a mindset, like you can have a knowledge, a head knowledge of the word, but you have to have a revelation of it for breakthrough, all right? So I want you to come to these classes with an expectation, and we want to create an environment here of expectation for healing, because that's important too, because the Bible says our expectations shall not be cut off. What's your expectation? I mean, are you expecting breakthrough healing? You can have physical healing, emotional healing, you know, any kind of healing, financial healing, but the Lord is saying to us, we have to have a heart of expectation, all right? So, in Hosea 4:6, I think you have that scripture up there. Hosea 4:6 says that my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. And so we don't want to be destroyed for a lack of knowledge. And I think that most of us here believe that God heals and He wants us healed. And however we get our healing, okay, we press through and we have to hear the voice of the Lord for how He wants to work through us, all right? And so many are destroyed because we don't know what the Word of God promises. I mean, I have heard many times people say, well, why is God punishing me like this? God doesn't punish with sickness. That's not God. Sorry. He died on the cross. He was brutally beaten for us for healing and deliverance and resurrection life. He does not punish us with sickness, okay? So we'll get that out of the way. But God reveals Himself to us as our healer. And so one of the first names, well, in Exodus, it's not one of His first names that was revealed, but in Exodus 15, that was when He revealed Himself as Jehovah Rapha. And so we know these are His redemptive names, and one of them is Jehovah Rapha. And it was interesting because when the Israelites came out of Egypt, you know, they were in the wilderness. God got them through. They crossed over the Red Sea, but there was a lot of bitterness in their heart. There was a lot of murmuring and complaining. Now think about it. These people were in captivity for 400 and some odd years. All right, so now they're getting out. And think about it. When you don't know and you're not real familiar with, you know, where you're going. I mean, it was new. I mean, who had ever heard of a Red Sea splitting, right? Think about that. And they had the Egyptians behind them, and they were really frightened. And, you know, if you put yourself, like, in their place in the Bible, how would you be acting, right? But a lot of them got really angry with Moses, and they had the Bible says they were in bitterness of heart. And so that can cause sickness. A lot of our heart, rotten heart attitudes have judgments and bitterness. Lord Jesus, especially politically what's going on, and, you know, who's angry with this person? Who's mad at this person? You know, the vaccine, if you got vaccinated, who didn't want to be near you if you weren't vaccinated? I mean, come on. This is the church. We have to rise above that. And we have to love and honor and respect each other. My goodness. And so we can't act like the world. So we have to check our heart, but they were in bitterness. And so I thought it was really interesting when I was looking up Jehovah Rapha. I love, love, love studying the names of God, and I really love teaching on it. But in Exodus 15, Rapha there, it's Jehovah Rapha. It means, I am the God who heals. But one of the versions that I was looking up in the commentary, it said that it literally means healing is what I am. So he is the I am that I am, and he is all that we need him to be. And he's a covenant God. We have covenant with him. And in Psalm 89, it says that his covenant, he never alters. We have a covenant with him. It's eternal. It's not a contract. That God is rooting for us. He's on our side, and he wants us to have a revelation of healing. And so in Psalm 105:37, in the New King James, it says, he brought them out with silver and gold, and there was none feeble amongst his tribes. I mean, think about it. They were in the wilderness for how many, 40 years? Their shoes didn't even wear out. I mean, come on. And so we want to really meditate on the word. And I'm telling you right now, we're going to go through a lot of scripture. And we really, really, really have to get a revelation of the word more than ever. I know we're all loving God. I know we all read the word, but I mean, we have to become so one with the word. And in Joshua 14, 10 and 11, it says, and now behold, the Lord has kept me alive, as he said, these 45 years, ever since the Lord spoke this word to Moses while Israel wandered in the wilderness. And now here I am this day, 85 years old, and yet I am as strong this day as on the day that Moses sent me. Just as my strength was then, so is my strength now for war, both going out and coming in. Well, I am standing upon that word. Lord, he's saying we get better as we get older. He's just as strong. You know, a lot of times the mindset is, well, I'm getting old now, and, you know, I'm going to be weak, and, you know, I'm not going to be able to do this and that. That's a mindset that has to shift. He was stronger. He was just as strong as when he started. And so I love that Caleb anointing. And so in throughout generations, God manifested his divine healing amongst people. Now, Malachi 3:6 says, for I'm the Lord, I do not change. Hebrews 13:8 says, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So that same powerful life-giving spirit that was released to the disciples that took place in Acts, that these disciples saw Jesus laying hands on the people, that opened blind eyes, that raised people from the dead, that healed them, you know, the woman with the issue of blood that healed them, is available to us now. And so the word hasn't changed. And so in Luke 9:11 in the Amplified, it says, when the crowds learned of it, they followed him, and he welcomed them, and he began talking to them about the kingdom of God and healing those who needed to be healed. So healing is a fruit of the kingdom of God. So we hear a lot about the kingdom of God. Well, what is it? You know, the Bible talks about our healing. It talks about our deliverance. You know, it talks about healing and cleansing the leper. It talks about resurrection life. That's the kingdom of God. It's not a church thing. It's a kingdom thing. And we are kingdom people. And so, you know, as I've been meditating on this, I said, Lord, I'm not operating in what I want to be operating in. And so I've just really been meditating on the word. And, you know, and you all have heard my testimony about when I was pregnant with my second son, and a doctor said that, you know, he wasn't alive, and they had to do an emergency C-section. But for 9 months, the Lord told me to meditate on the word. And I did it, and I would speak over every part of my body. I would meditate on the word. I didn't even think I was going to have labor pains. I mean, I was just like, I mean, you get so filled with the word. And so that gave me the strength and the fight in me when the doctor, now again, the doctor's not my enemy. They only are doing what they knew to do, right? But when he said, we believe your son is dead, you know, I was like, no, he's not. I mean, the word was so real that I'm not receiving what you have to say. It's not happening. And you know, and I also said, and I will not have a C-section. I decreed that the whole 9 months, because the first time I did have one, and I didn't want one. You know, for those of you that had them, God bless you. I did not want another one. I had the first one. It hurt. So I took a stand for the word. That's the power of the word of God. But see, I heard the word. That was what the Lord told me. That's why we have to hear his voice. So, you know, another person shouldn't do what I did. You know, you have to hear what God's telling you to do. That's why it's such a personal thing. That's why we have to establish the altar of intimacy. We have to go deeper than ever before. Enjoy that time with him. You know, we're in tabernacle season. This is a time of rejoicing. And really, just the joy of the Lord is our strength. I mean, talk about, you want to be strengthened? Have joy. Enjoy yourself. Go out with your friends and families. Just do something different. Enjoy yourself during this time. But anyway, so we know that healing is a fruit of the kingdom. Now, in Acts chapter 8, 4 through 7, says this. Now, those believers who have been scattered went from place to place preaching the good news of salvation through Christ. One of these things that I want you to be aware of, as I was writing all these scriptures out, it never said that Jesus was teaching healing. It either was preaching the gospel or preaching the kingdom of God. And so it says here, so I'll read it again. It says, now those believers who had been scattered went from place to place preaching the word, the good news of salvation through Christ. Philip the evangelist went down to the city of Samaria and began proclaiming Christ, the Messiah, the anointed one, to them. The crowds gathered and were paying close attention to everything Philip said. And as they heard the message and saw the miraculous signs which he was doing, validating his message. For unclean spirits, demons shouting loudly, were coming out of many who were possessed and many who had been paralyzed and lame. And they were all healed. Now, Philip wasn't one of the apostles at that point. And God wants us to know that he's using every one of us. It's for every single one of us. But see, the thing is, he was proclaiming Christ. It was Jesus. And he had an expectation of them getting healed, of deliverance. Because it says here, they were healed, but it says unclean spirits manifested, and demons were coming out of them. So in 1 Corinthians 4:20, in the Amplified, it says, for the kingdom of God is not based on talk, but on power. And it is God's will to heal us. And so we have to meditate on that, like all night. You know, just meditate on the fact that he wants us operating in the miraculous, every single one of us. You know, I was thinking of Dodie Osteen, and when she was diagnosed with cancer 25 years ago, right? And so, and she has a booklet of her testimony about how she was healed of cancer. And she said day and night, she listened to scripture day and night, day and night. And she kept a recording. There was another guy I was listening to. He had this horrible growth on him. And he said all he did, that's all he could do because it was such a terrible situation that, and because of his cancerous. He said day and night, night and day, he declared and spoke the word and spoke the word and spoke. Seemed like nothing was happening. And how many times do you know that, like, when you're praying, sometimes it seems like it gets worse, right? But see, we can't go by that. We're not going to allow the enemy to interpret our situation, amen? And so he was meditating and meditating, and one day he got up, the whole thing fell off, you know? But see, that's the power of the word. That's the power. Jesus is the word. It's resurrection life. And so when we not just, oh, I know that scripture. No, no, no. Take time. Meditate on it. You know, that word meditate literally means to regurgitate, right? To go over and over and over again. But it also means to imagine, to see yourself, in that situation, to see yourself in that Bible situation. You know, and just take time and just go over. No, that's what I do. You sing the word. You worship the word. You not worship the word. You worship the Lord, but you meditate on the word. And so I'm telling you, I think that, you know, from when I first got saved to now, I'm not saying anything that you people aren't reading your word, but most people do not read the word. Right. Don't read the word. Right. When you are in the word, there's a difference. Man, there are times, you know, when you're having a bad day and you just feel real. And so you just, I'll go upstairs and I'll just start praying in the spirit. And I'll just get the word out and I'll just start singing it to the Lord. Man, talk about a shift in your heart. It's supernatural. And the enemy will always try to stop us from doing that. And I know you know this, but don't you know we all have to hear it. I know I have to restudy it all the time. And so when we meditate on the word, faith is born. It's impossible to please God without faith, right? And so when we know the will of God in our heart, in our hearts, faith rises. I know beyond a shadow of a doubt, the Lord wants me healed. Now I have to hear a strategy from the Lord. There have been times when, like, my kids were battling an illness when they were small. I just knew that, I didn't need to take them to a doctor. We're good. I just had such faith with it. Then there were times they had this little, I'm like, oh my God, I have to take him to the doctor. There was just in different places I was at spiritually. But also, there's no shame in going to a doctor. Amen. Right? So when you, because like some people misinterpret and think that when you're speaking about faith, that you cannot go to a doctor. So I just want to clear the air here, okay? We can go to a doctor. Sometimes, I mean, that's just, if the Lord's directing you to go, you go to a doctor. Nothing wrong with taking a medicine. But in the meantime, I'm going to meditate on the word. The doctor is not my Jesus. I still have to hear what the Lord is telling me. There have been many times I've been, you know, hospitalized, or I've done, not many times, but I mean, I was hospitalized or have gone to doctors and they've given me prescriptions. I thought, I'm not taking this. I don't need this stuff. And I didn't take it. But then there were times that I know, I'm not saying like if I had the flu or something, you know, I didn't take something. But they were like for stomach issues. I'm thinking, I don't even have stomach issues. And they wanted to give me a pill for stomach issues, you know. Sometimes they're too quick to write little prescriptions, you know. So I'm just more of a naturalist and I prefer not to go that route. But there's nothing wrong. Please don't ever feel ashamed if you have to go, if you go to a doctor. It's okay. You still trust God through the whole process. Okay, we got that out of the way. All right. Oh, yeah. So one Christmas, I broke my wrist. And so they took me to the hospital. It was actually Christmas Day, I think it was. And we were in the room. And it hurt a lot. And so they started to give me morphine. And I hate morphine. I hate that feeling because, you know, you get like yup-chuck with that, right? And so my husband's in the room with me, and he's going to pray for me. So he prayed over my wrist, but he prayed that I wouldn't feel pain. Didn't pray that I'd get healed, but he prayed that I wouldn't feel pain, okay?
Sorry.
So, and then he ran out of the room. He took off. He ran out of the room because he can't handle this stuff. So I said to the doctor, all right, hurry up. I said, just do it. And so I'm doing my Lamazum, you know, because he said he had to break my wrist again to reset it. Ugh. So I thought, just hurry up and do it. And so I opened my eyes. I said, well, hurry up. And the doctor looks at me. He goes, I just had a complaint last week that someone was so angry with me and said that I was too rough. He said, I already did it. You didn't even feel it. I said, that was my husband. He didn't pray for me to get healed. He prayed that I wouldn't have pain. Well, I didn't have pain. So, I had the cast on. But anyway, so yeah, so prayer works. Every time my husband prays for me, pretty much I get healed. Yeah. So anyway, so Mark 11, 23 and 24 in the Amplified, we all know this. It says, they call it Kenneth Hagin scripture. I assure you solemnly say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be lifted up and thrown into the sea, does not doubt in his heart in God's unlimited power, but believes that what he says is going to take place, it will be done for him in accordance with God's will. For this reason, I'm telling you, whatever things you ask for in prayer, in accordance with God's will, believe with confidence, trust that you have received them and they will be given to you. And so this is a promise. Like, we speak to the mountain. What's that mountain of obstacle? See, a lot of times we look at how big this situation is rather than how great God is. Rather than, hey, God is the God of the supernatural. God says that he will heal. God says that he delivers. And so are we looking at what and taking in, well, the doctor says this, or what does Dr. Jesus say? You see, it's not that I don't listen. I don't hear what the doctor says, but here's what the word of God says. And the word's going to have final say. And I'm going to meditate on the word. I'm going to do whatever it takes in hearing the strategy from the Lord. But it brings tremendous breakthrough. So speak to that mountain. What is that mountain? Are you battling with doubt and unbelief? We have got to address doubt and unbelief. We cannot overanalyze everything because God's spirit, it's a spirit to spirit. He's not asking us to intellectualize things. And that's what messes with a lot of us. And so When you get a revelation of the goodness of God, when I love studying the character of God and how good he is and how much he loves us. He's not out to punish us. He's not out to make a show and say, well, you know, you didn't do this right. You know, he's a loving God. Yeah, the Bible does talk about judgment. There is judgment, but not when he's training up his kids, not when he's trying to help us move on and get healing in our lives. He's not there to, you know, smack us upside our head. He's saying, you know, I want you to understand the amazing love and the compassion that he operated in. And Jesus moved with compassion. And we have to be people that move with compassion and not have an attitude, you know, with people if they're battling. Well, you should have trusted God. I've heard people say that's their problem. They just should have trusted God. Well, when you're going through something, how many times have you been sick and you just don't have the energy even to pray? Right. And then you have someone saying to you, well, if you just said, you want to smack them upside their head. Are you kidding me? See, we can't have that stinking attitude. We have to have the heart of the Lord in that, okay, well, how can we be of help? Let us come alongside you and pray. Not, you know, talk to this person. Oh, well, I wonder what they did wrong. Well, come on. We're not the judge. And that's that religious spirit. And I'm telling you, God is coming with his fury to deal with the religious spirit in the church at large. I am telling you. Because that religious spirit sucks the life out of us. And it just obliterates Holy Spirit's presence. And I'm sick of that. And it's like we think we know more than Jesus with the rotten attitude. But we have to understand that's not the heart of God. God wants us to walk in his love and mercy, not that we let people walk all over us, but that we understand that we walk in the compassion and love of Jesus. The Bible says, imitate me, you know, not me, him, you know, imitate Jesus, act like him. How did he act towards people? Jesus didn't roll over and play dead. He spoke to them. He spoke truth. He didn't run after them, but he spoke to truth because he loved the people. We can't also just play, you know, basically, you know, a lot of times we're like, well, I don't want to get in the middle of this stuff. But we have to speak the truth and love to people. And so same with this. So I love this portion of scripture in Mark 5, 22 through 25, the Amplified. And it says here, one of the synagogue officials named Jairus came up and seeing Jesus fell at his feet, begged anxiously with him, saying, my little daughter is at the point of death. Please come and lay your hands on her so that she will be healed and live. And Jesus went with him, and a large crowd followed him and pressed in around him from all sides. Now, what I love about this is Jesus met all, you're going to see all these different examples where Jesus met them right where they were at, okay? And so it says, my little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her. But he was anxious. He was afraid. And Jesus didn't say, well, you know what? You need to get rid of that anxiety here because I can't deal with that. That's not his heart. But he met him where he's at, and he said, my daughter, my little daughter's at the point. Please come and lay your hands on her. That was his request. And Jesus said, okay, I'll come. I'll do what you're asking. See, the power of our words. Jesus does what we're asking, right? And so Jesus went with him. And Jesus will meet you at your point of faith. And Jairus said, like I said, come lay your hands on her, all right? So then it goes down, if you read further. Now, you think about this. Here you are. You finally get Jesus. You're so anxious to get him to the house to pray for your daughter. And now the woman with the issue of blood comes. Could you imagine? I would have said, you had this problem for 12 years. Could you just wait, right? I have to get to my daughter right now, you know, But God was so gracious and merciful. So then there's a woman in the crowd, and she had suffered from a hemorrhage for 12 years and had endured much suffering in the hands of many physicians. She had spent all that she had and was not helped at all, but instead became worse. How many? We know what that's like, right? She had heard reports about Jesus, and she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his outer robe, for she thought, now here we go, If I just touch his clothing, I will get well. She was prophesying over herself. And that's what we need to do. We need to keep speaking the word. If I can just get to him. Lord, here's what your word says. Father, your word says that I am a healer. The word says that your power through me will bring deliverance. Not the problem. We keep rehearsing the problem. Guess what? You're going to keep getting miserable. And she says, if I can just touch him. And that's that picture. I love that. If I can just touch him. Right? And so immediately her flow of blood was dried up and she felt in her body and knew without any doubt she was healed. Oh, Lord. And immediately Jesus, recognizing in himself that power, or another version says virtue, went out of him, he turned around. He said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, you know, everybody's, you know, pressing in and touching you. And she was afraid, because you all know that women, when they were sick, if they had the issue of blood or whatever, if they came into the crowd, she could have been stoned to death. And they're still like that in Afghanistan, in these countries that hate women. And that's an antichrist spirit. Wherever women are not honored, that is an antichrist spirit. And so she was afraid and trembling and aware of what happened to her, and came down before him and told him the whole truth. And he said, and I love how Jesus responded to her. He said, "Daughter, your faith, your personal trust, and your confidence in me has restored you to health. So go in peace and be permanently healed from your suffering." Isn't that awesome? That's how he sees us, as daughters and sons. When we're coming before him, the Bible says he's attentive to the cries of his children. He's not, even when he's silent, we sing those songs, even when it seems like he's not answering, he's there. He's answering. Don't ever give up. His delays are not his denials. Wherever right now you feel hopeless, because he heals the brokenhearted, where you feel disillusioned or disappointed, just say, "Lord, I don't know how you're going to do it. That's not my problem, but you know how to do it. And I'm not going to allow disappointment. I'm not going to allow the whispering or the tutoring of the enemy to dictate to me how I'm moving forward. Not happening. I'm going to trust God, the word of God, even though everything in my flesh may want, you know, how your flesh a lot of times gets in agreement with that whiny spirit. But it's like, no, no, Lord, I choose to trust you. I choose to believe that with you, in Luke 1:37, it says, with God, absolutely nothing shall be called impossible. Lord, your word says, and, you know, and I'll rehearse the word and I'll go over it. And I'm telling you, you get strengthened, you get lifted up. There's power in the word, because Jesus is the word. See, so we have to, you know, God is calling us to a higher level. We cannot lag behind. We can't just go and read our Bible every other day. I'm really encouraging you to meditate on the word. The Bible says in Joshua 1:8, meditate on the word day and night. Therein you will have good success, and therein you will prosper. Are you doing that? I mean, I know I've increased my time, and it's not a works thing. It's a God thing. It's just, I want my spirit refreshed. God is releasing double. God is just doing an amazing thing. I want to just read this scripture. I was meditating on this morning, and it's in the Message version. Where is it? Okay. I didn't give it to you, Reyes, so don't even bother looking for it. Okay, Isaiah 61:7. Listen to this. It's out of the Message, and I'm going to prophesy this over each and every one of us here. Because you got a double dose of trouble and more than your share of contempt, your inheritance in the land will be doubled, and your joy will go on forever. Isn't that good? And I said, "Lord, you're releasing double portion." Boy, this past 18 months has been a little challenging for a lot of us, right? With different things. It says, because you got a double dose of trouble, the Lord is saying, more than your share of contempt, you will inherit, and you will be doubled, and your joy will go on forever. Listen, your inheritance in the land, what's your land? Your home, your family, your workplace. Your inheritance will be doubled, and your joy will go on forever. Now, that's a scripture to meditate on, to speak over yourself. Don't just keep looking at how bad things are. Decree, prophesy over your life, right? So then we have here, all right, so he met the lady. He said, "Daughter, your faith will be made whole." Now we get back to Jairus. So in verse 35, in Mark 5:35, it says, while he was still speaking, some people came from the synagogue, from the official's house, saying to Jairus, "Forget it, your daughter's died. Why bother the teacher any longer?" How many times are you standing for something, and the doubters or the unbelievers around you are trying to, you know, put you down for your belief system? And that's why you have to watch who you're sharing your stuff with. And so your daughter has died. Why bother the teacher any longer? So overhearing what was being said, Jesus said to the synagogue official, "Do not be afraid. Only keep on believing in me and my power." So that's another word of the Lord. Do not be afraid. Only believe and keep on believing in his power. in him, and he allowed no one, listen, now this is a strategy from God. He allowed no one to go with him as witnesses except Peter and James and John, the brother of James. They came to the house of the synagogue official, and he looked with understanding at the uproar and commotion. And it says, and people loudly weeping and wailing, and they were already mourning. And when he had gone in, he said to them, why are you making a commotion and weeping? The child's not dead, but is sleeping. And what did they do? That devil, I'm telling you, that spirit, it says they began laughing scornfully at him because they knew the child was dead, but he made them all go outside. And so what did he do? He's making unbelief go outside and took along the child's father and mother and his three companions and entered the room where the child was, taking the child's hand. And he said tenderly to her, Talitha cum, which is translated, little girl, I say to you, get up. Now, we have to understand that the enemy always is going to have people with, you know, and not that people around you, it's not so much, I'm not saying they're the devil, but the devil wants us to get so intimidated by what's not going right. And that's why I'm not saying that you can't be around people, but I don't share all my stuff with people. I'm not real interested in what everyone thinks. Here's what the word says. Here's what I'm choosing to believe. And that's the bottom line. I'm not looking to hear people say, oh, you really believe that? You really believe God's the God of impossibility? I don't care what they think. And so watch who you're talking to. And so I don't need people to discourage me. And so, you know, because see, what happens is they don't have a revelation of the word. They don't have a revelation of Jesus, our miracle worker, the miracle man, the loving God that he is. Had it not been for Jesus on my side, where would I be? Oh, my God. I honestly don't think I'd be alive. I really don't. In Matthew 8, 5 through 10, in the Amplified, it says here, as Jesus went into Capernaum, a centurion came up to him, begging him for help and saying, Lord, my servant is lying at home paralyzed with intense and terrible tormenting pain. Jesus said to him, well, I'll come and heal him. But the centurion replied to him, Lord, I'm not worthy to even have you come under my roof, but only say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I am a man subject to authority of a higher rank with soldiers subject to me, and I say to one, go, and he goes, and another to another, come, and he comes, and to my slave, do this, and he does that. And when Jesus heard this, he was amazed and said to those who were following him, I tell you truthfully, I have not found such great faith as this with anyone in Israel. And Jesus met him again with this guy's faith. He did what the guy said. He just sent the word. Now, you know that scripture in Psalm 107:20, it says that he sent his word and delivered them from their destruction. Well, we're his mouthpiece. So as we send forth the word, but see, we have to send it in belief, not unbelief, but we're believing God, that we send forth the word and that it brings deliverance. I'm not saying sometimes it can happen immediately, but a lot of times it's like a battering ram. You know, you're going, and you're decreeing the word, and you're decreeing the word, and boom, you know, you have breakthrough. And it's like, oh my gosh, and talk about the joy of the Lord being God's, you know, your strength. So the Lord is encouraging us tonight, get the scriptures. What are the scriptures you're standing on? What are the scriptures? Listen, the enemy is going to constantly be whispering to you about how bad it is, how terrible it is. But you know what? Rise above that and say, here's what the word of God is saying. And ask Holy Spirit to give you the strength to fight, you know, that war that's going on with you. Because I'm telling you, God is releasing, and I've said this before, he's increasing an awakening of our prayer life, but also there's going to be signs, wonders, and miracles. But guess what? That includes all of us. That's not certain people to just pray. As you pray for people, like when I first got saved, I didn't even know where to find half these scriptures, but I just started to pray. I really believed it. I felt like I had this gift of faith, and I really believed it, and I just started praying. And I'll be honest with you, the first three or four people I prayed for and went to the hospital, they did die, but I didn't stop. And I kept praying, and I kept praying. And guess what? People were getting healed left and right. And it was because you have to be a doer of the word, not just a hearer. We have to step out. And don't be afraid. And, you know, you just keep getting, the more you do it. I mean, we heard, what's his name? John Wimber. What did he say? Over 100 people he prayed for before he saw healing in their ears, right? You keep doing it, but the more you do it, your faith rises up. And God, it's just amazing. You have to activate it. That's activating it. Oh, yes. So one of the guys, when we had our cafe, one of the guys had gotten listeria, and he was in the hospital in Pennsylvania. And I asked, there was someone visiting from Holland, and I said to her, would you girls want to come with me? I want to go pray for him because we're going to take authority over this thing. And he had a shunt in his head, and they were giving him 24 hours to live. And we went and we prayed, and when we went to pray, we were praying, and I was praying in his spirit, and I was taken. And now in this particular case, there was a spirit of death, and so, you know, the Lord really revealed to me that there was a spirit of death that we were addressing. So I took authority over, and I said to these girls, I said, make it like you're praying in Dutch. I said, and we're just going to pray real loud and furiously in tongues. And so the nurse kept walking in, and she goes, it's not going to work. Nothing that you're doing is going to work. And I thought, who asked you for your big mouth opinion? But, of course, I didn't say anything. I thought it. And so I just would look at her like, get out of here. And the enemy was using this woman. And so we just kept praying. And as we started praying, he started flailing. Because, you know, he wasn't conscious, and his name was Jacob, and he just started flailing. I said, you spirit of death, you come out of him in Jesus' name. The next day, he was sent home. He was totally raised up. And so, you know, despite what the nurses were saying, despite, you know, them coming in, another time, I went to the South Bronx to pray for someone, and she was, this kid, he overdosed on drugs. And he was also a criminal. So outside the room, there was a policeman. And so the cop said to me, you can't bring your purse, you can't bring anything in. And I had a little booklet by Charles Capps. And I love these little booklets. This is something that I cut my teeth on. And his book, it would be the Gospels. And he would say, just like you take pills 3 times a day, meditate on the word as your Gospels, right? So I had that in hand. I thought, well, I'll just give it to this guy. So I was praying, and I'm praying I was there for 2 hours, and I'm thinking, and I kept hearing, you're making a fool of yourself, this kid's not going to get healed. And as I was praying, tears were coming down his eyes. So the nurse comes in, she goes, that just happens when people are in a coma. Nothing you're doing is working. Another one that comes in and says that to me. So I thought, you know, go outside. So I just kept praying, and I'm really feeling intimidated. You know when that happens when you're going to pray for you? And I'm like, oh, my God, Lord, I don't know. And I said, well, I'm going to just act like, you know, like I'm, yeah, this is God. But meanwhile, I'm like, get me out of here, Lord, you know, because that intimidate, that spirit that was there. And the presence of the Lord fills the room now, because thank God. I'm like, help me, you know. So I'm there by myself, which I shouldn't have gone by myself, to the South Bronx. And his mom comes by me, and when I went to lay hands on her, she goes flying. And I'm like, oh, my God, in the hospital, you know, what am I going to do here? She's on the floor, you know, and I'm getting her up. And the cop comes in, and he said to me, and he has his wide-eyed, and he said to me, oh, my God, there's a presence of God here. So, wait. So then, of course, I was still intimidated. I said, will you pray for him? So he goes to me, no. I said, no, you pray for him. You came in here. You pray for him. So then he did. He said a short little prayer, and I'm like, all right, let me get the heck out of here. So I prayed over him. His mom and sister were there. He was sent home the next day. And from what I heard, this is like, gosh, about 8 years ago. He came to. They had him in a wheelchair. They were going to give him, what do you call that, when you're training, you know, physical therapy to walk. And and they were working on his salvation. So he didn't get saved right away, but that's all right. The Lord met him where he was at, you know? But see, what I was doing there is I was praying. I was just decreeing the word. I was just speaking the word. I was reading that little booklet, right. front and back. I was like, oh, God, have mercy on me. I was so intimidated. I wasn't even in full faith. And God met me where I was at. because I was willing to go. And it wasn't even for me. It was for this kid and the mom and the sister that were praying. Two of her other sons were murdered. I just had such compassion. I felt so bad. Now, this is her only other child, and she had a daughter that was there. And I thought, Lord, you know, you just felt so bad for this situation.
Can I just say what also about Jacob, too? So we knew this guy from the cafe, and he was a new Christian. And he called up after Trisha had prayed for him. And, you know, he only had 24 hours to live at the time. And he said, hi, this is Jacob, you know, the guy that you raised from the dead? And I'm having a little dizziness. Would you mind praying for me again? Oh, was that it? I'm sorry.
He said, I'm having double vision. And he said, can you guys pray so that my eyesight will be restored? And he came to the church, and other people on our prayer team prayed, and his eyes got healed. So
booster shot.
Yeah, amen. Holy Ghost booster shot. So anyway, so, you know, God is just so good, but he wants us to step out in faith, and he wants us to grab hold of the declarations. He doesn't want us to be afraid. He wants us to believe. He wants us to know. You need to look at your hands every day and say, my hands are healing hands, you know, because we're little Jesuses here on earth, right? Amen. And so I just love reading through these scriptures. Now look at this one in Mark 2, 1 through 12, and he amplifies about the paralytic that was healed. It says, Jesus returned to Capernaum, and after a few days later, the news went out that he was at home. And it says, so many people gathered together that there was no longer room for them, not even near the door, and Jesus was discussing with them the word of God. Then they came, bringing to him a paralyzed man who was being carried by four men. And when they were unable to get to him because of the crowd, they removed the roof above Jesus. And when they had dug out an opening, they let down the mat on which the paralyzed man was lying. And when Jesus saw, it says here in the Amplified, their active faith springing from confidence in him, he said to the man, son, your sins are forgiven. Yeah. Isn't that awesome? I mean, you know, it's like you have to persevere, and you don't give up. You press through, and you believe God. And then I just wanted to show you the progression. You know, he sent out, I don't have to read through it because I don't want to keep you late. He sent out the 12 apostles, right? He gave them power to tread over scorpions and serpents. And it says here, he imparted to them authority. We have authority and power. He imparted to them authority over every demon and power and to heal every disease. That's us.
Right.
So it's like, all right, Lord, I'm going for it. I remember I had to go to the hospital to pray for some guy that was going to have open heart surgery. And here he is, like, in bad shape. His mom asked me to pray. And I thought, all right, I'll go. And I didn't know the son. And so when I went there, his girlfriend met me at the door thinking I was going there to flirt with the guy. I'm like, are you kidding me? I don't even know him. So anyway, I get there, and I'm like, I'm here to pray, you know? So he was going to have open heart surgery. And it was just really childlike faith. And I went. And I brought somebody with me. We laid hands on him. And I said, Lord, you know, just give him a new heart. I'm asking you for a creative miracle. He was sent home. He never needed the surgery. Yeah. My sister Anna, you know, we told the story. This is a funny one. I went to her house. The Lord, she had endometriosis, and she had to have surgery. And she was Antichrist at the time. My sister Anna, who comes to church, she's probably watching online. And she did not want to know about Jesus. And she had gone through a very difficult divorce and was really struggling and blah, blah, blah. So I said to her, I said, I'm telling you, I need to come to your house because I believe you're going to be healed. And she wouldn't let me. She said, no. She hung up on me, which aggravated me. So I thought, I don't care. I'm going to her house. So when I got there, she didn't want me there. And she opened the door slightly. And I got my hand through the door. And I pushed the door open. And we're hitting each other. And I said, G told me to come and pray for you, and I'm going to pray for you. So we're going back and forth. And, you know, and I got my hands on her, and I said, be healed in Jesus' name. Of course, you know, I pushed her. And then she slammed the door, and I left. And so I thought, phew. So anyway, I get a call. I'm at work the next day, and I get a call. And she says, of course, I'm like, what? So she said to me, you're not going to believe this. She says, I'm here at the hospital. And she said, and the doctor, they took another x-ray of me, and I'm totally healed. My insides are that of a 20-year-old. And that was with fighting. So, you know, God meets it. But when he gives you a direction, he tells you to do something, we have to obey, right? So anyway, so we see that God has given us power and authority. But what you say, well, why doesn't everyone get healed? I don't know why. I just know that's not going to ever stop me from praying. But I do know when I think you all would know that when you're really filled with faith, and the other times you don't feel like you have the faith. Like, but I'm going to tell you something. There have been times I prayed for people and I thought, Lord, I don't even have an ounce of faith, and the person got healed. Yeah. Then there were times that I really was like, and they didn't get healed, you know. But it's so the Lord just said to me, he goes, Trisha, I don't want you analyzing things. I want you to trust me.
Right.
Just trust me. But I'll tell you, the meditation of the word is my emphasis tonight. Because it works both ways. Yes, for the person who's praying for you, but also as Christians, we need to have become so one with the word that we're married to it.
Right.
And at the word that it just bubbles up within us. And that he's a very present help in time of trouble and whatever we're going through. And so, God... So I said about he sent the disciples out. Then in Luke 10, he sent the 70 out. He appointed them out. And then in the Great Commission in Mark 16, he said, go ye into the world. But listen to the way it's worded here in the Amplified. It says, later Jesus appeared to the 11 disciples themselves as they were reclining at the table, and he called for them to account for their unbelief and hardness of heart. And that's what I'm going to ask you tonight. Is there unbelief or hardness of heart in your heart? I mean, we all have to, we're in tabernacles. We're in, you know, we had the Day of Atonement, and, you know, where we go before the Lord and ask him to reveal in our heart and our root system, you know, and sometimes we don't even realize we may have stuff, right? And so, you know, that's my heart. It's like, Lord, show me my heart. And believe me, he's more than willing to show us. And so I don't want unbelief. I don't want to have a hard heart. And I don't want to have unforgiveness, and I don't want to have bitterness. And so I have to go before the Lord and ask him for that help, right? And it says here, because they had not believed those who had seen him after he had risen. Because
right.
We try to figure everything out. We analyze stuff. And he says, and then he said, well, go into the world, preach the gospel to all creation. He who has believed in me and has been baptized will be saved from the penalty of God's wrath and judgment. But he who has not believed will be condemned. But so here's the deal. It's so... As I close tonight, is there unbelief? It's not a condemning thing. Like, I have to always... There's areas in my heart that I have great faith, and there's other areas that I have little faith. I don't have such great faith. So what you do is meditate on the Word. Get the Scriptures there. I confess it before the Lord. Say, I need help in this area. And I'll meditate on it, and I'll sing about it. I worship the Lord. And, you know, and I've shared this before early on. Bob Sorge, because I said, Lord, I don't know how to really worship you. And Bob Sorge, remember, he said to me, he says, what you do is, he says, just open up to the Psalms. He said, and just sing them back to him.
Right.
It was very simple. And I thought, oh, okay. And so, I got the Amplified, so it gave me more words. But I would just start singing them back to the Lord. And then, I'm telling you, one day, it was like after 10 days, I remember because I was timing myself, you know, I'm like, well, I'm only going to do this for 5-10 minutes, and, you know, and then, you know, I'll read the word. And it was after the 10th day, I'm telling you, you know, like they said, I don't know whether I was here in heaven, here on earth, I don't know where I went. And that there was like an open heaven that broke through.
Amen.
That was phenomenal. And it's very easy for me to enter into that place. But it was just person, just going, don't give up, and praying, and just, it was just, I was just, I got so into the worship piece. That's why the enemy hates worship.
Right.
Because he knows how, what the breakthrough that comes. And so, so I just want to encourage you with that. I have a lot more scriptures, but, you know, I gave you a lot. You have your handout. And what I want you to do is meditate on the scriptures. I mean, there's so many scriptures. Psalm 103, verses 2 through 3. Bless affectionately, gratefully, praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not one of his benefits, not one of all his benefits, who forgives every one of your iniquities, who heals each one of your diseases. You know, I stand on that. In Psalm 91:16, with a long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. I didn't even get into Isaiah 53 and 1 Peter 4. I didn't even get into those scriptures. There's so many scriptures on healing. And I had a bunch of stuff here that I was going to talk about with covenant, but I'm not going to go there. But I want you to meditate on the word. Fill yourself up with the word. I'm sure you're reading the word, but do it more. Fill yourself up. Meditate on the word, decree the word, speak the word, sing the word. Think about it day and night. That's what it says. Meditate day and night. Are you meditating on your problems day and night? Which one is it? Right? So I want to encourage you because we have healing hands. Right. And in this day that we're in, God is saying we've got to rise up. We've got to hear from him. We've got to lean into him. And because the people out there need healing. Right. I mean, we need it in the church too. But the people out there need healing. What's that? Yeah, I'm going to be done in a minute. So people out there need healing.
Pray for me.
Hey, you know, we got two preachers here that want to keep talking. Anyway, so are you willing to do that? You have your scriptures there. Could you meditate on it? And then, you know, with Google now, you can just Google everything. Yeah. And look up scriptures and just meditate on it. Remember what I said about Jehovah Rapha? I am the God who heals, but it really means healing is what I am. He is our healer. He's our deliverer. And whatever you're going through, whether it's physical healing or emotional healing, I want you to be encouraged tonight that he is your healer. He's answering your prayer. Don't give up. Don't give up. His amazing love. I love that. His mercies are new every morning. He's singing over us. He dances. He rejoices. I want you to imagine that. I don't want you to see him like mad at you. I want you to see him rejoicing and singing and just enjoying you. Think like he calls us his little children, right? Think of when a little child is coming, how cute they are. And, you know, like he's enjoying when they're coming to us with wanting to be with us. Well, he loves that too. When we want to be with him, when we're coming in faith and we're trying to learn something, he's there to help us. So I just want to encourage you with that. All right, hon, you want to say something?
I do. I just saw a picture, so work with me. I don't plan to keep you long, but if you're dealing with a medical report right now that you need physical healing, could you stand? Okay, now I'm sure those of you that are standing have had God touch you in the past, right? So I'm not doubting that he hasn't already moved in your life, but I would just like you to stand where you are. And those of you that aren't standing, if you have a testimony of God doing a physical healing in your body, could you stand now? Trisha talked about it. I'm standing. Linnell, come on up. David, come on up. Diane, you've had physical healing. Come on up. Anybody else that would have a testimony? Stand on this step here, okay? All right? So now, the ones that are standing up here, we're saying that we know beyond a shadow of a doubt that had to be God that healed us. I'm believing a lot of you that are standing with a bad report also know that, but we just want to just pray for you, right? We just simple prayer of faith. Want to believe God for you, that as he's done it for you in the past and he's done it for us in the past, and we're standing here without a bad report right now, just to say by faith we want to release healing into your lives right now and not make it real complicated, right? The Bible says fear not. That's what Jesus, Trisha quoted that verse to that father. Fear not. Don't give an entry point into fear. So could you guys just stretch your hands towards the ones that are standing and those that are sitting and anybody at home right now? This is for you as well, because he's no respecter of persons. You can't earn favor with God. He loves you and he wants you healed. So Lord, we just say release your healing power in the room right now. I really felt like he wanted to just kill cancer cells in people's bodies. I kept hearing that while I was sitting there. I know, Tom, you've have a testimony as well of being healed of cancer. I know, John, you're struggling. I know there's other people that are dealing with it. And we just say, cancer, die now in the name of Jesus. It's called consumption in the Bible. We say we reverse the consumption of cancer that's destroying people's cells. And we say the immune system be strengthened now in Jesus' name. And it's in the shape of a cross. It's amazing. They're called T cells. And we say, rise up in the immune system and destroy the attack of the enemy. And Lord, we say, let God arise and let his enemies be scattered right now. Sickness was taken to the cross with you, Lord, and it's part of the redemption that you gave us. You destroyed that spirit of sickness and death, and we say, move mightily among your people. Our assignments are not over. You have more for us to do, and we want to be busy about our Father's work, Lord, and we just speak life and health and energy. We speak new organs in people's body, that resurrection power. You call the things that are not as though they are. And we say, Lord, with childlike faith, we believe you for what you say. And we say, bring it now. Bring restoration. Bring new organs into people's bodies. And give us that compassion that Trisha was talking about, that will meet people where they're at with childlike faith and just say, we believe God can heal you. Would you receive your healing? We just speak it over you now in Jesus' name. Could you pray in tongues for a minute and just speak it out? Like I said, when we pray in tongues, we're speaking to God. Hurababa santa ba ke shoto. Brimbebe ki se tereba ki shoto. Brimbe ke sanaba ke soto rabo ke shenderebe ki sandado. Rambaba. On earth as it is in heaven, Lord, we say, on earth as it is in heaven, bring heaven into this realm and destroy sickness in Jesus' name by your power. Restoration of Holy Spirit. Renewal. Renewal. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Did anybody feel anything? Because if you did and you can do something now that you couldn't do before, go ahead and exercise that thing that was hurting. All right? And give a demonstration of the power of God. There's a momentum that happens with testimony. If you've been healed tonight, do something you couldn't do before. Sometimes you can't always tell because it's on the inside. But Lord, by faith, we say healing has been accomplished tonight in this house, online, any other way. Anybody that sees this, Lord, we say there's no respect of persons with you. You love everybody and you want them healed. We cancel that unbelief and the assignment of the enemy, and we just speak life and health over everyone here and watching in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Dave's going to speak next week. He's got a bunch of testimonies I know he can give. And have an awesome day tonight, and then be back Friday if you're going to be here for the...